Oh boy. It is. Hey, it's 6:05 and we are on a roll today on this great 555 day. And so I am super duper excited to be talking with Kelly Price. This is my favorite song of hers. So I see that she joined, and I'm sorry, I can't pin the information. I didn't copy it right, but it is text LOHM 5520 to the number 41444. For Giving Tuesday, to give to the Ladies of Hope Ministries, to help us continue to do the work that we are doing.
I feel way underdressed right now.
Because it's my day.
Oh my God. I did pull out a new wig for you today, though. I had a different one on yesterday.
Look, but we're channeling the same color. And I said, when I was looking at your page earlier today and I saw the comment about cleavage, I said, let me put on a little cleavage for Kelly there.
Listen, honey. Oh my God. You know, whatsoever we do. And I love this because I'm getting to know more about you, which is what's so super exciting about today. Whatsoever we do it classy. We remain ladies. If I'm just going to be all the way for real, I just wasn't in the mood when I got that message yesterday. I'm grieving my grandfather. I lost him. I couldn't go bury him in New York. He got COVID. Like, of all the things that you want to pray about right now that's going on in the world, you want to pray about my cleavage? I should have wore something a little more low cut today. What was I thinking? But I did channel you on the hair. So I'm doing something.
Yes, you did. And the color. And the color.
Oh my God. You look beautiful.
Thank you.
Well, everyone, first,
let me send condolences to you first on the loss of your granddad. I am.
1 second. I think my internet is trying to act ignorant right now. You are just closing my ignorance. I'm talking to my internet. Do not get ignorant on me. Okay.
Okay. Here I go. Okay, great. I said, one, I'm sending love and healing and peace to you on the loss of your granddad.
Thank you.
New York, and we are the epicenter. So I am aware, and it is incredibly devastating for how families are unable to really just bury their loved ones and
it's
send
terrible.
Them home, celebrate them in that way.
It's terrible.
So I am sorry for your loss. But
Thank
also
you.
Understanding, you know, I lost my dad in January. And I laughed to my mother and I said, you know, Mom, Daddy's funny because he made sure he got up out of here so that we could celebrate him properly before all this mess started. Reverend Butts, he said, we the ones to worry about, not them. So,
yeah, you know, they're actually better than we are.
Absolutely.
But you lost your dad, so you understand. I tell people my grandparents were like my parents.
Okay.
And so it wasn't the typical grandchild grandparent relationship. Somebody asked me, "How do you feel?" I said, "I feel like I'm an orphan."
Oh wow.
So, but you know what? He is. I had him for 94 years. So I celebrate him.
God bless.
He's an amazing human being.
God bless.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank
you. Well, you look great, so you
Thank
know.
Thank you. I'm trying to hang in there. Hey, guys, tell somebody to log in. Tell everybody we're talking, and we have a lot to talk about, and we need to talk. I'm excited about what we're talking about today. And when I can travel again, I need to come see you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. I would love that. Where are you?
I'm in Atlanta now, but I'm New York born and bred. I'm New York born and raised. Like, literally, I was just in. They shut Atlanta down on the 16th of March. I was in New York on the 27th of February throwing my grandfather a surprise birthday party.
Oh, wow. Oh, okay. So yeah, you're right here. So yeah, I definitely see you. And I come to Atlanta too. So it's all good. Yes. We'll be seeing
each
other soon.
It's a quick trip. They just won't let us fly right now.
Absolutely. Right. Right. So tell me a little bit about you and like how are you impacted by incarceration?
Gosh. So I'm a young Black woman who was born in the 70s, raised in the 70s and the 80s in New York City, Southside, Jamaica, Queens, Far Rockaway, Edgemere Projects is where I grew up. And it's so funny. I tell people, depending on which side of me you tap into, I don't know if that's my sound. Let me try to fix my sound. I tell people, depending on which side of me you tap into, on my mother's side of the family, everybody's preachers and singers. And on my dad's side of the family, interestingly enough, most of them were like drug dealers and guys that were in the streets. So I have two very different sides to my family. Most of us that grew up in the hood in New York are familiar with it. And so I was impacted by it because I had family members who were jailed. As a young kid, there was kind of a dividing line with those of us who were going to church and then those of us who had chosen another lifestyle. But this impacts all of our community because this, like healthcare and many other things, the sentences are disproportionate. The sentences do not fit the crimes.
Yeah.
And we find that people who are brown, people of color, tend to do longer sentences for things that people of other cultures tend to get a slap on the wrist for. And I've really been paying close attention even now in this season with this illness that's going on and them saying that they want to send nonviolent offenders home. I'm watching the penal system find reasons to keep nonviolent Black and brown offenders in while they're letting out people of other colors.
It's so true.
I'm watching it happen. I'm watching it happen.
It's so true. And it is. And I know that, you know, to your point, I don't know if you know that women are also even more disproportionately incarcerated and get larger or longer sentences for the same charges as their male counterparts. And so when you even think about, there's a sister, Lenore Logan, who's in Pekin, Illinois, and they are beginning to release people who have COVID from the prison, but she made a point to tell me there was a list of almost 50 women that she put together of women who are eligible right now to leave, and they are not releasing any women of color at all.
It's systemic. It's absolutely systemic. And so what's so funny, I don't know if Carlene had an opportunity to tell you, I've known her for like 2 decades, maybe a lot longer.
Everybody knows Carlene for like 2 decades.
Everybody knows Carlene. I've known Carlene for like 2 decades. And as a kid, being raised in the church, I just always saw myself as the girl that was singing the church choir. I never thought I would do music for a living. Mm. And so I was in debate club and I was really good at winning arguments. So as a young kid, I was like, what can I do that I can make a lot of money and not have to wait in the cheese line anymore and not have to sleep outside anymore? And I always wanted to be a lawyer. So the crazy thing is I literally, when I was in elementary school, I was identifying places that I wanted to go to college. I wanted to go to John Jay Criminal College in New York City, like literally from a young kid, because living in those neighborhoods, I watched it. I saw it happen. I watched the cops in our neighborhoods. They moved very, very differently than they moved in Long Island, where I had cousins. You know, the cops moved differently in the projects than they moved in the suburbs.
Yeah.
It was a different kind of thing.
Long Island. In Mandeville.
In
the suburbs. So I understand what you're saying.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I actually felt safer around the guys that I knew were selling in my building than I did around the cops. And anybody that's ever grown up in a housing project or in a neighborhood like that, particularly in the time that I was growing up, I'll say I can't speak for it now, they would understand what I'm saying. I felt safer around the guys that were doing that in my building than I did around. I really did. I was more afraid of the police officers than I was of the guys who, you know, if you ask them, they'll tell them I'm doing what I need to do to feed my family because ain't nobody trying to give me a job. Mm. And I'll never make excuses for anything, but we do know, again, the way things are set up, we don't get information in a timely fashion, if at all.
True.
Things that programs and things that should be made available to us They don't let us know about it.
It's very true.
They're happy with us not knowing what our rights are, which is why we have to be intentional to connect with women like you, with brothers like Brother Lewis. It's necessary. We can't simply take the attitude, oh, well, it's not my problem. Yes, it is. I'm the mother of a young Black man. Mm. My son is 28 years old. He lives in LA. It drives me crazy. Do you know how many times he's been pulled over just because he's a Black man driving?
Mm.
I have a real fear. But again, like you said, it's not just the men. It's anybody that's Black and brown now. My kids are in their 20s, and I literally am more concerned about them than I was about myself growing up in the crack era, in the early onset of AIDS era in New York City in the projects.
Mm.
I had another level of awareness because it was another time, and I grew up in a single-parent home in the hood, but it's just different. It's different.
Wow.
I mean, and that is, I applaud you.
Thank you so much. That's such a powerful point that you're making, to say that, you know, in what is categorized an unsafe neighborhood, you feel more safe than when you do the police that are actually supposed to come and assist and serve and protect the community. I recently just saw on Until Freedom's page, shout out to my son and Tamika Mallory and Carmen Perez, where they posted, it was one shot of during COVID, how the officers were, it looked like Central Park, but there was a group of young white people who were in, you know, talking in community, but yes, they were not within their social distancing. And yes, the cops were actually handing out masks. And then how they're in Brooklyn, I believe it was, that there was young Black men, and this cop beat this child, because he was a child, and said on camera that the reason why he was responding that way was because he did not have a mask. And so the fact that, you know, here in New York, how we are further being criminalized, one, because the resources aren't in our communities, right. Two, there are price gouging. I mean, even up here at the little beauty supply store, and I live in the Bronx, by me, they are charging like $5 for the little surgical mask, for one. And I'm like, how are they allowed to do that? And so when you think, you know, in other areas, in different areas in the community where there are things that are already lack, you know, how is someone going to afford to pay for one mask? Or if they have three children and they have to decide whether or not they're going to feed their kids because they just lost their job, because now COVID has happened and more millions of people are filing for unemployment, which then leaves for these systemic issues that then cause the overcriminalization of people of color, specifically women, which again is then taking and ripping our families. And it's this cycle. Right. Yes. So I heard you say Brother Lewis, shout out to Lou. You know, I saw
he's amazing.
You on, he is, he's incredible. I saw you on the faith panel that Cup 50 had done, and I was like, oh my God, I love her. He's like, oh, that's nothing. I was like, shout out to Lou.
Oh,
you know, that's
thank
how you
Lewis.
Take care of your sister.
He sings your praises.
Aww.
He literally sings your praises. He said, you definitely need to meet Topeka. You all need to connect. We can't physically do so right now, so we're doing it virtually. But that time will come too.
Really, absolutely.
This work is important to me. I don't see how anyone of color in this country doesn't see the necessity to involve themselves at some level. And everybody can't do the same things. We understand that. We compartmentalize. We all have a lot going on in our lives. But at some point, get in the know.
No, absolutely. And you can do it. You
can
do it, to your point.
Just by spreading information.
That's right.
In your locale and in your community and among your family members and your friends.
That's right.
And at your church and on your job, because we all know someone in this life who is going to be pulled over and handcuffed while they wait to run their tags to see if they have any warrants.
Mm.
And we're just going to keep you in these handcuffs just in case you decide you want to get by. Like, that's not happening to people
this
of
is
other
so true.
It's
this
not
is
happening
true.
To people of other hues. I've been harassed by police officers as a Black woman, and had some horrible things said to me. So I want to be clear. I don't want to make this about just the police, but we just need to say what it is. I'm not saying that all police officers are bad.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is when you have a fraternal order, or whatever you want to call it, of people who are designated to protect and serve, and then you have a group of those who choose to abuse that power and that authority, and who take advantage of feeling as though there's a sector of people who don't well enough know their rights to stand up for themselves or to fight back or to even understand, I don't have to allow myself to be searched if there's not probable cause. And literally the intimidation factor, all of these things, we can't be brown and black in America and not be intentional about knowing these things, because not knowing it has cost some people their lives.
Absolutely.
It's cost many of us our freedom. Every last one of us has someone in our family or close to us who has been improperly searched or pulled over or has served time. And I promise you, no matter what it was, being black or brown and not having proper representation or not fully understanding and being aware of what your rights are in this country, they did more time than they should have done.
And that's the bottom line, right? And when you think about, you know, it is so true that, you know, we can't think that we're going to change what's happening in the system if we don't talk about the things that is driving it. And racism is what's driving it. So that's clear, right? And then as you think about racism, then you have to look at poverty, right? And who's the families and the communities that are impoverished? So it's either heavily communities of color, and then it's poor white communities. And then when you think about the number of impact that's having around incarceration, is one in every other adult has had an impacted loved one. And that is irrespective of race. Why? Because now what's happening in those suburbs and the places that I grew up in, you have what's now drug abuse, and you know, the opioid epidemic is now considered a public health issue where it has been. Now we're looking at this global pandemic around COVID as a global health issue, when mass incarceration has been. So the country is recognizing the problems that are happening around incarceration and our people. But now, to your point, our people need to be more educated as to how this is impacting our communities. And for the police, I mean, to your point, yes, we have people who are policing our communities who aren't from our communities. And so how can you understand what's happening? Yes. I know that one of my friends, they were talking about how in Brooklyn, you know, it's a lot of gentrification and things have happened, and people give cookouts and parties and all of that. It's how we do community. And that there were a white family that came into the block and they called the police because of the noise ordinance. Like, these are things that are happening that are different because new people are coming into communities and don't understand what that community is.
And the culture.
And the culture. So it's incredibly important that we also educate ourselves, communicate with local elected officials, you know, understand the power of voting, run for public office. Support people within those communities and teach our children, because they don't know. Like, I know, when you think about voting, I used to vote for the president. I used to vote for the black person that I saw on, you know, the little signs hanging on the and that's how I voted, period. Yes. I didn't know I need to vote for the public advocate, for the state senator, for this person. Yes. I had no idea.
Yes, the alderman, the district person over here, the councilman.
The sheriff, the district attorney, you know, the judge. I had no idea, right? And so when you become educated, it's so incredibly important to share that information. Yes. And I appreciate you for utilizing this time to allow me to share the information that we are doing at Ladies of Hope Ministries around the information around the impacts of incarceration.
I love that name, by the way.
Thank God actually gave me that name when I was in prison. And I'm going to tell you something. When I came out and I started the organization, and someone who I had just met and was working and organizing with, she was like, you cannot name your organization the Ladies of Hope Ministries, because people are not going to donate money and people aren't going to do this. And I'm going to tell you, I raised over $1 million in my first year with the Ladies of Hope Ministries. So I said, let me tell you about God. God will allow anything as long as you are obedient and you listen to God. So the Ladies of Hope, I started off, I laugh, as the Lady of Hope Ministry. Now it is the Ladies, actually.
Yes, ma'am.
And a mighty, powerful group of ladies we are, and continuing to spread the word around the impact that incarceration has, but not just on those of us that actually have lived in a prison, but those of us who have loved ones that lived in a prison, because the extension of incarceration is, it impacts all of us. So, you know, I can't wait to meet you in person.
I know. So true story. As a kid, again, here I go back to my grandfather. Did so many things in ministry as a kid. They used to get special permission when they would go do prison ministry, because I was a kid, I wasn't allowed to come in, but they would get special permission so I could go with them when they did prison ministry, and I would sing in the women's prisons when they would go and minister in the women's, when I was a kid. So, like, I'm there, believe me when I tell you, for so many reasons, I'm connected to it, and it means a lot, and those things are important too. Like, I've always felt like I want to be more involved in just making visits, coming to talk to the women. These women are going to jail, they're leaving their children behind. Some of them are having babies while they're in jail and then having to have those children ripped from their arms. Like, I'm a mother. I couldn't imagine. And I think just as humans, as people who say we are God-fearing, as people that say we love God, as people who call ourselves global citizens, we have to be more intentional with our humanity.
That's right.
And we really have to live life from a standpoint of what would life be like if I was walking in those shoes? Like, you can't just assume you know why something is what it is. We have to be able to step back and say, if I had to put my feet in that sister's shoes and walk a mile, forget a day, would I make it without complaining about my feet hurting?
Listen, I want, but the thing
is, you don't know what that sister's burden is.
Right, just try a day, you know? It's like, let's walk the mile, but let's try to day. Because so often, people don't even understand. I shared a story earlier just about dropping food off to a women's domestic violence shelter and how there were little kids in there. It's all women and kids. And how the little kids, the one little girl's face lit up. And she was like, oh my God, that is so much food. Like, I've never seen that much food. And I completely broke down and cried. And when I talked to one of the sisters there, she worked on Wall Street and all these, but to understand that every single woman in there had to escape an abusive relationship to save themselves and their children.
And now
they're in what's supposed to be a place to save them, but yet it was a place that looked worse than even the prison, some of the prisons I had been in. And these children aren't getting food. And so when you think, you don't know what the next sister is going through. Even in that very moment, you don't know the demons and the pain and the trauma that she has faced that has maybe even been born into her, right? Through generations of things that have not been healed. So I think it's just so, so incredibly important that, you know, we continue to love each other. We continue to try to heal each other. And to your point, we understand and we say, like, look, sis, I love you, right? Like, acknowledge that. Like, I don't necessarily mean it.
Can we say it and mean it? Because I'm about to abolish the word sis in 2020 because it comes off with so much. You know what I'm saying. You know exactly what I'm saying. I'm literally about to abolish the word sis in 2020. Because most of the time when somebody sisses you, they really be ashamed. When we call people sis when we were growing up, and it wasn't even sis, it was sister, because we meant it.
You're right. My friend, Valencia from Florida, when she says that, she'll say sus.
Right.
She's being shady. What's up, sus? Like,
I applaud her for at least acknowledging in the moment. Let me switch this up a little bit, because this ain't even really that. But most people are doing it. But let's, for real, we have got to get back to that. If we even think about it, would you agree that a lot of the desperate situations even that some women find themselves in to do the things that they do for the man that they love or to support their children or whatever the case may be, it's literally because we don't have that network of community?
No, absolutely. You would be more comfortable with doing something else than to go to your sister. To have a network of strong women that you feel comfortable and confident enough to be vulnerable, to say that you need help, right? So often we put on, I mean, when I went to prison, first my friends were like, wait a minute, hold on. Like, why you didn't call us, right? But for me, it wasn't about any of that. For me, you know, my story, and when we have more time to talk about it, it was just me with the lack of self-love, the need of acceptance, because I grew up in a white community. Because my parents thought that was better than their growing up in Harlem in the Bronx. that when I got to a black college, HBCU, I wanted to fit in. And so I started to transform into what I thought blackness was. And so that created me buying into the narrative that was created about way we were supposed to be. And so
we did that to each other. To your defense, we did that to each other too. Because
this is true.
We were quick to tell somebody, yo, we were revoking your black card. Like, what is that? You don't this, you don't that.
You
that black no, am I telling the truth?
No, I'm laughing because people used to tell me, oh, you talk like you're white, or you're pretty to be dark.
What is talking like you're white? Or, what, speaking proper English?
Right, right. So, you know, you're right. This is true.
Yeah, because but what I'm saying is that we do it to each other. And a lot of times there are a lot of things that we can say happen to us as a result of being oppressed from outside of our communities. But a lot of times they can just sit back and fold their hands and watch us do it to each other. We have to be more intentional. Black is not one thing. Just like we're not one color, we're many wonderful hues of brown and yellow and peach and golden. And just like we're different hues, we come from different neighborhoods and different backgrounds. And we all have different levels of education and understanding.
Right.
It's not one is better than the other. We're just different.
Different.
We come from different places. And so being forced into the box of black is what has gotten us in so much trouble. Black is too big.
So true. So true. And I mean, with all of the greatness and the beauty and all of the differences that we have, we who are believers and understand, we are all wonderfully, beautifully and wonderfully made.
Yes.
So, you know, in the end, you know, when you evolve to really understanding that, and like you, I was raised in the church. I wasn't a singer, but I did play piano. My music was a little different.
I love that. That's what we're going to do. That's what we're going to do. We're going to get somewhere where there's a piano or a keyboard. It don't even have to be official. We're going to go live. You're going to play the piano and I'm going to sing. That is the moment.
I'm here for all of it. Just let me know the song in advance so I can practice.
So you can practice it. That's the moment we need that. We can take it back to church. That's all good. I go to church very well. That's always going to be my first, my last, my everything.
Oh, fantastic.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
This is just so incredible. I am, again, so grateful. This was such a pleasant surprise.
Yes. And thank you to Carlene for reaching out because she said,
thank you, Carlene. Shout out to you.
The town hall meeting, and it's such a crazy time. Literally, it has been such a crazy time. My grandfather passed on Resurrection Sunday morning, but he was just buried last week.
Okay.
And well, you know, it's New York and everything is crazy and just. Again, we're still trying to work and keep things moving and trying to check in on family members around the country and make sure that everybody's good and that they can get what they need. I probably haven't sat down and had a meal in 2 days. Like, just sat down and ate a meal. I probably haven't sat down and eaten in like 2 days. Just kind of stretching myself thin, but trying to make sure that everybody's okay, checking on the neighbors, checking on older family members in other parts of the country and that kind of thing. But this is the thing that I've been seeing everywhere throughout this time. I've been sheltered in place since the 15th or the 16th of March. We really have to look out for each other. Yeah. If you know that there are people, just go check on your neighbor. We still gotta be socially distancing and we have to be responsible, but just yell from the curb. Like, pick up the phone and call somebody. Text. If you don't have your neighbor's number, shame on us, because once upon a life is, if you had a phone in your house, somebody on the block had your phone.
That's right. That's right.
And I literally just said, we could borrow 2 eggs and a cup of sugar till the end of the week. Back in the day, we could do that to get through this, to get through all of it.
If we
could just change the narrative in our community,
it
shifts a lot of things.
It
shifts us losing people to a disease that the world doesn't understand. It shifts us losing our young brown and black boys and girls to a system looking for self-love and self-awareness and self-acceptance because we're telling them if you're black or you're brown, you can only be this and you can't be that. If you're that, then you're not really this. And we're not going to welcome you into our clubhouse. We have to stop all of that. From where I come from, I mean, I was 18 and pregnant and unmarried. And it was, believe me when I tell you, being born and raised in the church and coming from a family full of preachers, the looks from one side, and then on the other side of it, because I did grow up in the project, it was like, oh, well, what else did we think was gonna happen? So there were so many ways that statistic could have decided what I was going to be. That statistic could have decided what you were going to be for so many reasons. But
that's
whether
right.
it came earlier or later, something
that's right.
in you rose up and said, that's I'm right. not going to be what y'all said. I got to be because of this, that, and the other.
Mm-hmm.
I know I can be something else.
Mm-hmm.
I can be something else. And we have to be that. We have to be that to each other.
Absolutely.
We really, 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 really do. I crave a day where we can actually be the people we believe we are.
No. Tulane Montgomery from, she's a partner, New Prophet. She had told me one day we were walking in San Diego, and she was saying to me, it is a beautiful thing when a Black girl knows that she is who she is supposed to be.
Yes.
And that, what you just said, just reminded me of that.
Yeah.
Because the power that we have is just exceptional.
Yes.
And we do not really understand that because so often we are not told that. And though even, I mean, I have a family and a mother who told me and instilled that in me.
Yes.
When you get in the world outside of that little box, there are all these things that tell you that you are something other than what that greatness is that you are born to be. And so, you know, just hearing you say that, you know, gives me a sense of gratitude and pride of just being proud to know that in this very moment, for these, in this fifth year, that I am everything that God wanted me to be. And that I am just so incredibly grateful because I don't even know what else God has in store. I just know that it's going to be super dope.
Yes.
Because as all of the barriers are opening and the opportunities are coming, I'm embracing it all. And so, you know, you are one of those great opportunities to have, you know, that my song is gonna rain. I listened to that song on repeat so many times, girl, in so many days because it was raining.
listen,
but you know, after the rain, we've been endorsed for one night, but joy comes in the morning, and so
yes,
I am so grateful again that you know you don't know right why God brings us through the things that God does, but we do know that if we're obedient through that time, and we are still. When it seems as if it is something that is going to devastate us and we don't know how we'll get out, if we just look above, we know that we will be guided through that process. And I am just humbled in the middle of all of this. And, you know,
I need to flip
proud.
It though. I need to flip it though. I actually sit in the seat of humility and I'm humbled to look you in the face because of the work that you're doing. I think that too often, and I know this coming from people that worked in the communities to help people like my grandparents. It was a different day. But a lot of times people look past women like you, men like Lewis, because they're looking at what they think is bright and shiny and the people that they see on television all the time. And that's what's impressive to them. I am so unimpressed with my job. I am so unimpressed. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm unimpressed with my job. I'm unimpressed with what I do. It's a God gift. He gave it to me and he allowed me to walk through doors that my pedigree perhaps said I shouldn't have been able to walk through. And so with that understanding, I celebrate who I feel like are our real heroes, the people who the cameras are not on, the people who do the grassroots work and get their hands dirty to make sure that the rest of us are walking around with maintaining the freedoms that we don't even know we're supposed to have because we don't even go read about it or find out about it. And people who are going and doing the work to get bills passed to make sure that we are being treated equally and fairly. And we're not asking for anything more than what you're giving them, but don't give us less either. So I'm honored. I'm grateful. God puts champions like you among us for a reason. And just whether it was Paul and Silas or whether it was Joseph or whether it was John, these are all great people in the Bible who did jail time. We heard Dr. Jamal Bryan say it the other night.
Yes.
But thinking about that in this perspective, I've often gone back, whether it was in a Bible study or even in my personal study time, and I really looked and got an opportunity to see how God literally allows the things in us that we feel make us less than, that perhaps cause us to make not the best choices.
Yeah.
And we go through some things, but what comes out on the other side of it, the beauty, the strength, the ability to help people, walk them into their purpose, walk them out of their prison and into their purpose, mm-hmm. whether it's a literal one or it's a prison of the mind or whatever the
case might be.
What it all means is that it's not in vain. It's what it all means
Amen.
Is that it's not in vain. And that,
that's
and
right.
that God literally has his hand not just on us, but he literally gets his hands in the middle. And if we just yield to him, even after a massive mess up, if
That's
we
right.
yield to him and just say, listen, I tried it my way. I got to give this to you because I can't do it. I give up. He will. It
yes.
obligates him. When we surrender to him like that, it obligates him when we allow him to navigate us. To
That's
navigate
so true.
Us. It can be a bit murky because when you in deep, you in deep. It feels deeper before you get out and you feel that you can stand up and stand straight up and you're not wallowing it or maybe drowning in it anymore. But you get there. And the
That's
story
right.
on the other side is that somebody gets an opportunity to see that that where it is today is not where it always has to be. It really doesn't matter. I say this all the time. If God can do something with me, he can do something with anybody.
Hmm.
And people need to know that.
That's right.
They need to know that.
Ah. Well, thank you. Thank you so much. That's a
oh
whole
God.
Word.
Yeah. I'm so happy to be here.
I so appreciate you.
Thank you for having me on. I told Carlene I've been interviewing and talking about this new music all day long. She was like, would you surprise her with a song? I said, I don't know. I would be talking all day long. But I do want to just say this, and I'm just this little piece of a song for you and for anybody that's watching. Keep your faith in this time. God has not forgotten us. This is the time where we need to still ourselves. We
that's
need
right.
to hear. We need to receive instruction and move in wisdom. Do not let the anxiousness of the day cause you to make a quick decision that affects you and changes the outlook of your life and your family. Let's be wise. Mm. Let's use some wisdom. And a big part of that is us, again, looking out for each other, checking in on each other, making sure that everybody is okay. And I love this song. It's an old hymn. It was recorded by Mahalia Jackson many years ago, and I had the nerve to record it many, many years ago because I loved it. It blessed me. And it's a song that I remember from my childhood and became special to me in another way when I became an adult. But just everybody that's out there, I just want to say, many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds my tomorrow, and I know who my hands. Stay strong. Stay safe. God bless you. We coming out of this corona thing. And we gonna be all
That's right.
right. We gonna live to tell about the day that we live through a real plague.
That's right. And that voice. Thank you for that beautiful testimony. I just want, as we check on our loved ones who are in our
yes.
community, make sure that we are taking the phone calls from our loved ones who are incarcerated. Yep. They need
yes.
us. They need to hear our voices and they need to be home right now. So Kelly, I
yes.
thank you. I'm
thank
going
you for having
off
me.
To talk to Van Jones right now.
Tell Van I said hello.
So tune back in
yes,
at the LOHM. And please, guys, this is Giving Tuesday. We just got a beautiful song, but I'm asking that you please text LOHM 5520241444 to help support the work that we're doing so we can continue to help end poverty and incarceration of women and girls. God bless you, Kelly.
God bless you.
I thank you, and I can't wait for our duet.
So we can do this in person. I'm going to send you the song, and we're going to get them good on live.
All righty.
Yes, ma'am. Take care. Be safe. You look beautiful.
Thank you
so much. Have a great conversation with Van.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.